Around the world, migration has ground to a halt, as has overall mobility. Borders have closed down. There is very little international travel, and all components of migration have been affected. The protection systems have pretty much closed down. There is no resettlement, and some asylum seekers have an opportunity to lodge their claims, but very few of them. And there are virtually no adjudications of these claims. I will say something more positive than that after I finish these first few points. Family immigration is also ground to a halt. And this is, you know, again, the result of the fact that people cannot travel. Labor migration, however, is the one area in which there continues to be a little bit of movement. And the movement is in categories that we all now call essential workers. And as you might imagine, health workers of all types are considered to be essential workers. But the one component of labor migration that is most essential, at least the one component that most countries want to continue to be able to have access to, is agricultural workers. Because ultimately, the food supply in all of the advanced countries, the wealthy countries, but also increasingly emerging economies and middle-income economies, relies very much on agricultural workers from elsewhere. And that includes places as far apart as China to, of course, the United States and Canada. The other parts of labor migration are probably shut down, although I think it is important for us to say at this time that things are beginning to open up. The second point that I wanted to make is that the biggest factor in trying to figure out what might happen in the next, let's say, 3 months to 6 months, is tied completely to how vast and how long the economic devastation will continue and how deep it will be, again, for the rich countries, the wealthy countries. The devastation is, you know, unheard of. The only analogy, the only comparison is to the Great Depression. And I assume no one around this call was an adult at the time of the Great Depression, because that means you would have had to be about 110 years old today. So, and it is the perfect analog, because we have not experienced anything that deep, not even during the Second World War or in the aftermath of the Second World War. And the third and final point deals with the impact on the developing world. And this is already happening, but I think we're going to experience this more and more strongly in the months and next year or two from now. Remittances will take an enormous hit. The World Bank and the person who does these analyses and projections, Dilip Ratha, only a week or two ago estimated that there was going to be a $100 billion cut in remittances. But the last day or two, the World Bank came up with another estimate, and that estimate puts the drop to $142 billion. As you can imagine, for countries that depend very much on remittances, and I don't mean the country's economy, but for the people that receive that money, for whom remittances is essentially a lifeline, the concern that we should all have is that that lifeline will be much thinner and much more precarious in the months and year or two ahead. The final point under this impact on the developing world, we're already beginning to see that too, there is already a significant amount of return migration. Not return migration in terms of people leaving, let's say, stable positions and legal stable status, you know, in many of the rich countries, but people who are in more precarious situations in many of our countries, and also people who had been hoping that they were going to be able to get to find somehow their way into some of the wealthy countries and some of the more, you know, the strongest developing countries, they're turning back. I will give you one example because it shocked me. The Romanian government in Europe announced that in the past 7 weeks, 1.3 million Romanians returned to Romania. And we're already beginning to see traffic, you know, from, you know, the places where immigrants had been or would-be immigrants had been congregating near the U.S. Southern border. Those numbers of people have been are getting smaller and smaller. And Mexico estimates that there are only 10% as many foreign-born people in Mexico who are not permanent residents, don't have a permanent place in Mexico. Only 10% of those that were there 3 or 4 months ago are still in Mexico. The rest have gone back or have been pushed back. It's a combination of both factors. There has been an elite consensus that has allowed migration to continue to be large and to thrive. And that elite consensus suggests that because of the demographies of many of the rich countries, we will need a significant, substantial amount of immigrants and possibly even more and more immigrants. And we'll have to see as to whether that elite consensus continues to hold 3 and 6 months from now, when the sort of the depth of the economic devastation becomes clearer. And this is really the one thing to take out of this conversation, is that indeed, as we go forward, a lot of the assumptions that we have been making as to how many new workers we need are going to be re-examined. Because so far, because of these vast investments that governments have made, in the United States case, $6 trillion, numbers that you can't even imagine. $6 trillion, if you include, of course, the federal, you know, the Federal Reserve investments. And you have about $1.2 trillion in Japan and $1.2 trillion in Germany. And the European Union has another trillion plus. And then smaller countries, rich countries throughout the world, hundreds of millions more. This is an economic abyss. How we climb out of this economic abyss and how long it takes will determine how large the future migration flow is going to be. People will say, okay, if we need to slice and dice and decide, you know, whether to legalize a certain proportion of the people who are in the United States in an illegal status, how do we do this? But whether we can have an agreement between the two parties in the Congress that then can actually be signed by the President of the United States, you know, this is highly questionable.
Why are tropical forests important and why should we really worry about them? They're a source currently, as they're destroyed and cut and converted to cattle pastures and agriculture, of about 10 to 14% of the world's greenhouse gas emissions. So they're also that part of greenhouse gas emissions that cause climate change that we can probably slow down most easily in the near term. So they're a big part of any climate change solution. Beyond the carbon that's contained in the trees of tropical forests also have a huge cooling effect on the planet. As water evaporates from their leaves in the equatorial sun, they absorb a little bit of energy, and that is big enough, if you translate that across the entire northern part of the South American continent, in the case of the Amazon, Borneo, Central Africa, it's enough to affect how the climate is today everywhere. We're all in some way connected to these forests. And they're incredibly diverse in terms of plant and animal species, and in terms of microbes, and in terms of viruses. The Amazon probably has a couple hundred insect-borne viruses, and a large share of those, maybe as much as a fourth, cause disease. And so in some ways, the pandemic we're experiencing now should alert us to this threat and think about how we can affect it. We're coming into the burning season for much of the forest now. It usually begins in July in the southern part of the Amazon. That means that it's a time of respiratory illnesses, with thousands of people having respiratory ailments, asthma and other ailments, many people dying in normal years. And in this year, it's aggravated. It will intersect with the pandemic and will probably present a big health risk with increased illnesses and deaths. Currently, in places like Manaus in the center of the Amazon, Iquitos, in Borneo, our teams are telling us, and we're seeing the reports, that the health systems are already being overwhelmed. There's mass graves in the outskirts of Manaus. Loreto is not so much an issue of ventilators as it is of oxygen bottles, so just really basic things that people need. So we're coming into a burning season. I think we should be prepared for a real crisis of smoke pollution basically intersecting with the pandemic to create an increase in deaths. We read a lot about the Amazon burning season last year. Last year was actually a fairly mild year in terms of rainfall, and this year looks drier, and this year the deforestation rates are higher. So we should be expecting a worse burning season this year than last year. The good news is that it doesn't look like the droughts are enough to cause native forest, primary forest, to catch fire. I wanted to drill into a little bit, though, some of the human dimensions of the pandemic and how it's playing out, especially in these tropical forest regions. And first, it's important to think about how a lot of people get by. They get by, they turn to the forest for subsistence. They'll clear a patch of forest, dry it out as much as they can, set it on fire, and that prepares a patch of land for planting. With the ash, the nutrient-rich ash from burning that patch of forest, they can cultivate beans and rice and manioc and bananas and plantains and get by. And whatever they can sell. And it's a very precarious existence. It's an existence that goes back thousands of years with indigenous people. And it's a sustainable existence if there's a big enough area, because the forest does come back, it goes into fallow, and it can be cleared again. But these are incredibly precarious systems for living or selling that farm produce in local towns and cities. These are informal supply chains. So the farmers markets are often have very little in the way of sanitary hygiene conditions and precautions. There's very little in the way of processing support or even where the farmers sell it. We've heard probably of the wet markets of Asia where COVID-19, the coronavirus, probably was passed from animals to humans. And I think this is what we're seeing as a major impact right now, that as farm markets are closed down, these informal farmers markets, as wet markets are closed down, where fish and wildlife and forest products and agricultural products are all coming into the towns. As those are shut down, those people are unable to sell things and they're facing food security issues. And that's aggravated by the fact that there's a lot of wage laborers who can no longer afford to buy food. They've lost their jobs. And so that's a very big problem we're seeing. In Borneo, our team there is actually been organizing to try to set up just real emergency types of measures to get support to these people who either can't sell their food or don't have enough money to buy food. One thing that we think is going to happen is that people will go from cities back to their home territories where their families are, where they can still have access to food because there's a farming element of their family properties. A couple hundred thousand people have left Lima, Peru by foot to go to the Andean Altiplano, to go to the Amazon region where they're from. And it's incredibly dire circumstances to do that. Lima is in the middle of a desert, and they have to go up into the highlands and then down into the Amazon. So these migrations, I think, are going to become more severe, and that could itself put greater pressure on the forest as people turn to the forest and slash and burn agriculture and Sweden agriculture to survive. People who have good economic options, and be that in the forest or in the city, that is what we need to get to. And that means extending finance so that small-scale farmers can invest in different types of tree crops and agroforestry systems, processing, they can organize cooperatives, and really address this marketing issue, which is so precarious today. We need to see support going so that these supply chains are formalized, so that there's centralized processing, that there's good hygiene being practiced, good price support so that farmers are getting fair prices and that they can access better markets because their products are processed in a way that meets the standards of those markets, of supermarkets in cities, for example. This is fundamentally an issue of development. And I get nervous when I hear calls for, pull out of the Amazon, pull out of tropical forests. Let's cut off tropical forest products from markets, because I think that's exactly the wrong thing we need right now. Now is a time of solidarity, of collaboration, of partnering, of listening to the needs of local leaders from the farm sectors, indigenous groups, etc. See what they need and see how we can get that support to them.
My name is Dulce Gamboa and I work for Breath of the World. COVID-19 is expected to double the number of people facing food insecurity, and it's going to increase to 265 million within the year. So in other words, the world has never seen a hunger emergency like this. This is unprecedented. The coronavirus pandemic has also brought hunger to millions of people around the world, mostly because of the lockdowns and the social distancing measures that are drying up work and income for people, and is going to likely disrupt agricultural production and supply routes. And that really leaves millions to worry, and they don't know really where their next meal is going to come from. So what we are seeing around the world, and you on the screen, you'll see the list of some of the countries that we are watching closely in terms of hunger crisis. So what we're seeing is that people living in poverty, including large segments of poor nations, are going to hungry and facing the prospect of starvation. So as you know, in 2019, there are a couple countries, 10 countries that experienced the worst food crisis around the world. Among them, you have Yemen, the Democratic Republic of the Congo, Venezuela, Ethiopia, South Sudan, Syria, and Nigeria. So these are obviously some focal concerns for us as we continue to monitor the state of hunger and famine around the world. So I wanted to show you this map. I hope that I change this. So you can look here. So you will see that obviously the bigger circles are countries where the situation is a lot worse. in terms of hunger and malnutrition. So we're seeing that, you know, from Venezuela to Nigeria, this hunger crisis is caused by a multitude of factors linked to the coronavirus pandemic and the interruption of the economic stability and order. People are experiencing loss of income, like sudden loss of income, the collapse in oil prices, shortages of cash from tourism, drying up overseas workers that they don't have earnings to send money home. You know, like Dimitri was talking about, remittances, and that's such a big deal for people around the world, and ongoing problems like climate change, violence, and displacement are some of the issues and the factors that are making this crisis worse in terms of hunger. So we know that even if there's no major surge in food prices, the food security situation for people living in poverty is likely to deteriorate significantly worldwide. And this is especially true for economies like Sudan or Zimbabwe, where people were struggling even before the outbreak, or places like Iran, where they have increasingly used oil revenue to finance the purchases of good and food and medicine. So we know that this situation, it's going to deteriorate rapidly as we approach the end of the year. I wanted to quickly touch base in terms of Central America. You will see in the map that two of the focal points are Guatemala and Honduras and El Salvador. So this is a result, obviously, of movement restrictions within the region, a household income that is based mostly on informal economy, and that is just declining rapidly. We know that remittances from the U.S. declined in March, and many poor and very poor households are experiencing direct or indirect impact on their main source of income. And the overall, you know, along with the overall economic activity. So the other point that I wanted to touch base is Venezuela. We know that the pandemic is devastating millions there. Venezuela is the world's largest economy that collapsed outside wartime. And even before the coronavirus, about 9 million Venezuelans were already suffering from malnutrition, according to the UN, and so the latest development make it a little more difficult, you know, for the country to keep in quarantine. And, you know, what you have in Venezuela and in other countries around the world is that you have a sanitary crisis on top of a nutritional crisis. So it's just a very bad combo. And across, you know, Latin America, just to give you an idea, an estimated 113 million people live in low-income barrios, favelas, or villages, and families are definitely struggling to adapt the coronavirus lockdown and social distancing because of more immediate financial imperatives. And we know that people are more worried about being able to feed their families than they are worried necessarily about the coronavirus. So people are saying, you know, we're going to die from hunger before we die from coronavirus.